chochote utataka nitakupa ma.
Hey guys, welcome back to our channel. It's your girl Fanny Lungu, back with another reaction video. If you're new to this channel, make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course, do not forget to subscribe. Today, I'm going to be reacting to Why Do Innocent People Suffer? So without wasting time, let's get into the video.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله العظيم من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو حي لا يموت بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح للأمة وكشف الغمة وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك فعليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين وأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله وقد أمرنا بالحق وقال تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما ثم ما بعد. We begin by praising Allah and bearing witness that none has the right to be worshipped or unconditionally obeyed except for Him. And we bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is His final messenger. And we ask Allah to send His peace and blessings upon him, his family, his companions, those that preceded him from the messengers, and those that follow in his example. And we ask Allah to elevate us to be united with him in the hereafter, and to follow his sunnah and his guidance in this life. Allahumma ameen. Dear brothers and sisters, arguably the most difficult question of faith is theodicy, is the question of why. Now if you go through the pillars and the arkan of Iman, then you see that the last of the articles of faith is the belief in the qada and qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the belief in the divine decree and the predestination of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that is the pillar, as Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu says, that if a person establishes it, then they establish their tawheed, and if a person destroys it, then they destroy their tawheed. It is the most difficult thing to wrap our heads around, the most difficult things for our hearts to accept, the most difficult thing for us to stomach when we see tragedies unfolding before our eyes, the way we see Aleppo, Halab, unfolding before our eyes. And quite frankly, without the belief in Allah, and without the belief in the Akhirah, the belief in the hereafter, nothing makes sense. Nothing makes sense. Interestingly enough, when you go through the Qur'an, Allah stresses belief in Allah and belief in the hereafter. You don't see stress as much as you do on those things in belief in Al-Qadha' wal-Qadr, belief in Divine Decree, even though that is the pillar in the article that most people will struggle with. And there is a very important reason for that. Because just as without a strong belief in Allah and the hereafter, nothing makes sense, with a strong belief in Allah and the hereafter, everything makes sense. Everything is digestible. Everything is acceptable. Everything is tranquil. Even in the greatest times of chaos and havoc, everything can be resolved with the belief in Allah and with the belief in the hereafter. And that's why Allah stresses it. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Man amana billahi wal yawmil akhir," whoever believes in Allah and the last day, everything comes in between those two. So he sends his angels to his messengers with messages to preach the belief in Allah and the belief in the hereafter. And that resolves the problem of that question. So when we talk about the believers and those that go through difficulty in this life and are unfairly tormented for their belief in Allah or never see the fruits of their faith in this world, then we remember that as Allah tells us in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُضِيعُ أَجْرَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah does not let the good deeds of the believers go to waste. Two implications in there. Number one, a God who rewards. Number two, a time after this time in which that reward would be fully realized. Or إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. When a person suffers, whether that suffering is something that's due to a disease or an illness, or it's due to oppression or transgression, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Allah will not let their patience go unrewarded. Allah will reward their patience in ways that cannot be quantified. But then what about on the other side, those that transgress and the oppressors? وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ اللَّهَ غَافِلًا عَمَّا يَعْمَلُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Do not think that Allah is unaware of what the oppressors do. إِنَّمَا يُؤَخِّرُهُمْ لِيَوْمٍ. Allah delays them to a day. As the Prophet ﷺ says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيُمْلِي لِلظَّالِمْ حَتَّى إِذَا أَخَذَهُ لَمْ يُفْلِتْهُ. That Allah delays the oppressor until He snatches him and He never lets him go. In all of these ayat, in all of these ahadith are the two very important implications that strengthen that belief in divine decree and that strengthen our belief and allow us to proceed through this life in a way that, yes, we are saddened by events that unfold before us, but in a way that we are also proactive about dealing with what we can deal with. Humanity starts wars, and humanity ignores wars. Humanity allows for the death and destruction of over 250,000 people. In the last 5 years in Syria, 11 million displaced people, refugees, living all over the place and being dealt with cruelty. Humanity caused that and humanity ignored that. There is an oppressor and there are the silent observers. Those that have power and those that don't have power. Governments that could have intervened but did not intervene. And people that watched in silence and allowed that to unfold. And quite frankly, some people who were completely unfazed by it. Some people who chose to ignore it altogether. And when humanity messes up and humanity murders, people kill, people watch others being killed, people oppress, people watch others being oppressed, then what do we do after that? We ask God why He let it happen. How did you allow this? After we messed it all up, we turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our complaints. So on one hand, we want the free will to be able to reject God, to reject His orders, to reject His revelation, to reject His legislation, to live free without any restrictions. We reject when He calls us to charity and generosity and benevolence and mercy, and to take care of the poor and the vulnerable amongst us. But then at the same time, while we're rejecting God and we want to be free, we also want God to not let us be too free. We want Him to referee us. And we want Him to stop us when our free will gets us out of hand. Isn't that hypocrisy? Isn't that a double standard? Oh Allah, don't force us to do good, but when we mess up too bad, force us to stop being evil, to turn it back towards Him. After we try to demand our freedom of choice. So if God stopped evil, and if God did not give us the ability to do wrong, we know that Allah doesn't force us to do wrong. That's a batil creed, that's a false creed. As false as the creed that says Allah doesn't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We know Allah doesn't force us to do wrong. But if God stopped evil, then we wouldn't have free will. Then we wouldn't have choices. Then that would defeat the purpose of the entire human enterprise. Then we might as well be angels or robots. Either God forces us to worship Him, and it's, you know, we have no desires, we have no inclinations, or we're robots, just like a doll or something you push. Push the button of love. It's not real love, even though the doll keeps saying, "I love you," to the child. It's a doll, it's robotic. It's not real. So on one hand, do we want God to stop us? Or on the other hand, do we want God to let us completely go free to where we will ruin ourselves and where we completely mess up? So if we don't have free will and God stops all this evil when we blame it all on Him, when humanity messes it up, then what's the point of this world? Is there such thing as freedom without choice? Or do we really just not want other people to have free will and other people to have choice? Because we've somehow convinced ourselves that we're not that bad. And if we were in the position of government and authority and dictatorship, then we would be better than those that we criticize. If we were in that position of power, we would be so different. So ya Allah, let us continue to try to climb the ladder of our own professions and our own careers and our own pursuits of power. But don't let them get it. How does that make sense? Aren't we creating more problems than solutions in that case? And subhanAllah, when we think about even the idea of how we recognize good and evil, because to resolve this and say, well, maybe there is no God. Maybe we just all got here. Maybe this entire complex design, all of our DNA that's been written, all of our functions, all of that is all by accident. Maybe we're just here. And the proof of that is how bad we've screwed it up. That's the proof of how that there is no God. But the fact that you can recognize good and evil, and you can recognize oppression versus goodness and generosity, is a proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fact that that makes you uncomfortable, if you're a decent human being, seeing dying children makes you uncomfortable, and you can recognize what is good and what is bad, that's a proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in and of itself. That He gave you the ability to recognize. But people, humanity, human beings decide to stop being human and neglect those things. SubhanAllah, can you imagine what goes through the mind of a person when they kill somebody? Can you imagine these people walking through the streets of Halab, mercilessly brutalizing these women and children? What's going through your mind? Where is your heart? We can't even reason with that. Do you think they were born like that? Do you think Allah created them to kill women and children? Do you think that they didn't know growing up that it's wrong to kill women and children? And a part of them somewhere in there is probably telling them, while they're deliberately ignoring the good qualities that Allah put inside of them, somewhere in there, there's a voice that's telling them, this is wrong. You don't think that's there? It is there. But the fact of the matter is that when we become so powerful, when we find ourselves in positions of authority, often we are not godlike anymore. We are not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us to be. We lose our own sense of purpose. And all of those questions about evil and hardship and pain, and why does this happen? And why does that happen? The vast majority of it can directly be traced back to what humanity does wrong. Moral evil. Our own selfishness, our own intoxication with power, our own deliberate ignoring of the world's problems around us, our own gluttony and luxury and enjoying the things that we've been given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's face it, poverty doesn't bother you that much until you're in poverty, until you start to feel the pinch. Hunger doesn't bother you that much until other people, or until you feel some hunger. Oppression doesn't bother you that much as long as it's in another land. You know, subhanAllah, we think about the privilege that we've had as American Muslims this entire time. Or we thought everything would be smooth. We thought that the Islamophobia wouldn't get too bad. We thought we were just going to integrate with society seamlessly and no hate crimes would take place. That we can continue to remain in our shells. The privilege of being an American Muslim. Guess what? That privilege is waning away now. And it's not fun. It's not any fun. Other people have been living under that for a very long time. That times 100 and times 1,000. If the brothers can move forward, inshallah ta'ala. Other people have been living with that for a very, very long time. So when we think about the evil around the world, how much of it can directly be traced back to us as people? There is enough food in the world for every single member of the human race to have a 3,000 calorie diet. But we don't care about that until we ourselves feel the pinch of that hunger. And then you talk about the other evil. But what about this? And what about that? And there are good people that just suffer. Inexplicably suffer. It doesn't make any sense. And subhanAllah, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he saw the Prophet suffering, it didn't make sense to Umar. Why Rasulullah? Why him? I mean, he knows sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No one loves Allah like he loves Allah. His daraja, his greatness is already established. Why does he have to lose a third, fourth, fifth, sixth child? Live in poverty. Why? It didn't make sense to Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Umar walked in and saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this situation where he's rising from his bed and he's got marks on his back. Umar has a better bed. And Umar radiallahu anhu starts to cry. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I've seen the palaces of Caesar and Kisra and all these people. You deserve so much more than that. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Umar, أَمَا تَرْضَى يَا عُمَرْ Aren't you pleased, O Umar, أَنَا لَهُمُ الدُّنْيَا وَلَنَا الْآخِرَةِ That for them belongs this dunya and to us belongs the hereafter? The Prophet ﷺ is telling Umar, I'm okay with this. I'm okay with this. Don't worry about me. I'm content. Because I know my purpose in life. So yes, it hurts me when I go through pain because I'm a human being. The Prophet ﷺ cried when he lost his children. The Prophet ﷺ felt the pain of hunger. The Prophet ﷺ felt sickness and...
This video is very, very interesting. It's good that we have channels that are posting videos like this, real videos like this, talking about real life situations. And it's good that there's actually people behind this video that went all the way out to organize this event and to give people a platform to get educated concerning these things or just to have a discussion. And a very big shout out to the person that actually suggested this. Like he said, there's enough food in the world to feed everyone. That's what people don't realize. Why are other people suffering? There's enough, and then they're standing behind these organizations to help prevent hunger, to help do that. Many people are getting oppressed. The other day, there's a person that came out saying they're taking pictures of these poor people, putting them on their websites, what, but are those people being paid for that? No, they're not. They're being taken advantage of because they're in a compromising manner. It doesn't make sense that we're standing by silent when we're seeing other people going through all these things. It's up to us to help other people. And I'll give a full commentary in the second part of this because my camera is full. And just...
When I think about you,